Hi everyone, CJ here. This time, we are going to look at the 5th edition Ranger subclasses from Xenotar's Guide to Everything. Before we proceed, let's quickly talk about the elephant in the room. As many of you know, there had been a lot of talks about the Ranger getting revised. For those who are late to the news, I'm sorry to say this, but it's not going to happen. Jeremy Crawford, the lead rules designer of 5th edition D&D, tweeted this before the release of Xenotar's Guide to Everything. In the end, there will be one Ranger, the PH Ranger. It will get alternative features. The official game won't have two versions of a class. I am not sure how this is going to be finally implemented, but I will talk about it in this video right after the review. I want to review the new subclasses first, because if we take a look at them, we can start to piece together clues of what the alternate feature Ranger might look like. So let's start with the Gloomstalker. Looking at these subclasses, the first difference that you will notice compared to the PHB subclasses is that they learn extra spells at certain levels like Paladin subclasses. But instead of two, they only learn one at every interval. They didn't used to get any new spells in the PHB classes. But this format is similar to the new subclasses of the revised Ranger in the last Unearthed Arcana they published. The Gloomstalkers are supposed to be super stealthy Rangers of the Underdark. They are so used to the Underdark, they get dark vision, and even other creatures with dark vision can't see them in the dark either. No kidding, that's actually one of their features, Umbral Sight. That is also the only thematically relevant feature they have. Besides that, they get a few offensive and defensive features. Dread Ambusher let them add their wisdom modifier to their roll, and on their first turn in combat, they get extra 10 feet of movement, additional attack, and extra damage. The idea is that they can just pick off one enemy right from the start. Later on, they get Stalker's Fury, which allows them to make one additional attack if one of their attack misses. You might think, why don't they just get advantage instead? But I think the designers are wording it this way so that it can still work in conjunction with advantage when they cast greater invisibility on themselves, so they can be extra accurate with their attacks. As a result, it increases their total damage output in the long run. Their defensive features gives them extra saving throw proficiency, and they can use their reaction to impose disadvantage when an attack roll is made against them. Those features are thematically independent, but they are still useful. The Horizon Walkers are supposed to be guardian rangers of the multiverse, protecting the mortal realm from otherworldly threats. If you are familiar with Magic the Gathering lore, they are like the weaker ranger version of a Gatewatch Planeswalker. I guess it makes sense to have this subclass, since Wizards also released 3 Magic the Gathering setting supplements for D&D. With the upcoming release of Mordenkainen's Tome of Foes and its focus on extra-planar monsters, this subclass will become even more relevant very soon. Its thematic feature is Detect Portal, which lets them detect the closest planar portal within 1 mile. They also get some thematically relevant spells like Banishment and Teleportation Circle. This subclass actually has the best offensive capabilities among the three. The Horizon Walkers can use their bonus action to choose a creature and their next attack on it deal force damage instead plus extra d8 of damage. At higher level, that extra damage will double. Then, they also get another feature that lets them teleport before or after attacking, and can attack one extra time if they attack 2 or more creatures with their attack action. Combined with the haste spell they get with this subclass, it makes them very powerful. Their defensive features allow them to use the Etherealness spell to shift into the ethereal plane for a turn. They can use the opportunity to hide, run away, or go through walls. They also get Spectral Defense at higher level, which is like the Rogue's Uncanny Dodge, except that it gives them resistance to the attack instead of straight up halving it. With the Uncanny Dodge, you can quarter the damage if you stack it with resistance, so there is a difference there. Thematically, the Monster Slayers are supposed to be hunters of the supernatural, like Van Helsing or Hellboy, not large wyverns like the Monster Hunter game. However, they might as well be, because their features are so generalized, I wonder why they are called the Monster Slayer. It might as well be called Feature Package 3. Don't get me wrong, that doesn't mean that the features are not great. They get Hunter Sense, which lets them know an enemy's vulnerabilities, resistance, and immunities. It's got limited use, but it works on any creature, which is great, but not very team-specific. They also get Slayer's Prey. They can use their bonus action to choose a creature, and the first time they hit it on their turn, it receives extra D6 of weapon damage. It's not much, but at least it stacks with the Hunter's Mark and doesn't require the target to be hurt like the Hunter subclass in PHB. The Slayer's Prey get added feature at high level. When a creature is chosen by the Slayer's Prey feature, forces the Ranger to roll saving throws or roll to escape grapple, the Ranger can add D6 to the roll. Later on, the Ranger can use that reaction to attack that chosen creature, and their saving throw automatically succeed if the attack hits. They also get a feature that let them thwart a creature that is trying to teleport away from them within 60 feet. I can start to see that some of these features can be useful against vampires and mummy lords, supernatural creatures that can use powerful spells and effects, but it feels like it's a very narrow set of supernatural creatures. But at least it can still work against spellcasters in general and other creatures that can create special effects like dragons with their dragon's breath. Unfortunately, the saving throws only work for the Ranger and doesn't extend to the rest of the party. It is slightly disappointing, but it is still pretty good. These subclasses are quite useful. They have their strengths and weaknesses, but pretty light on the teams. I guess the base Ranger class already has a lot of tools for players to build a team with, and Wizards doesn't want to overcomplicate it. So in summary, the Monster Slayer is a surprisingly defensive subclass. Gloomstalker is good for changing the tide of the battle right at the first round. Horizon Walker is generally powerful for combat with some utility and defensive features thrown in. What is interesting about these subclasses is their format. It follows the Unearthed Arcana Revised Ranger subclass format very closely. They get extra spells, and the Gloomstalker is really just the Deep Stalker Conclave redone, with a few changes. Notably, extra attacks are no longer tied to the subclass anymore, so I'm expecting the Ranger alternate features to be relatively close to what they already have shown in the Unearthed Arcana, but retaining much of the current class's features. The extra attacks are most likely going to be tied to the base class. I think the alternate features will work like variant classes in D&D 3.5. Back then, they didn't have subclasses, but they had variant classes. How it used to work is that if the Ranger is supposed to get features like Favored Enemy, they get variant feature A instead. If they are supposed to get Hide in Plain Sight, they get variant feature B instead. So I'm assuming that these alternate features will work in the same way. Just swap certain features at the relevant level and call it a day. It's like the D&D version of a software patch. You can choose not to install it. I think they are doing this because they don't want to erase the current Ranger class, since it can render their existing PHP stock in their warehouse obsolete. Most likely, they still want to sell them, you know. Jeremy Crawford also teases the possibility of other classes getting alternate features. This means more customization. Personally though, I'm not sure what to think about it yet. I know that Wizards want to make more products to sell, but it might increase the barrier to entry for new dungeon masters. Even if every class only get one alternate feature set, it may potentially double the number of starting features new DM need to remember. Thus, it may take longer for new BDMs to gain enough confidence to start their own campaign. It might even go against the philosophy that makes 5th edition successful: the simplicity. Most subclasses doesn't kick in until level 3, so there is enough time for the DM to get to know the characters. Having alternate features for the Ranger makes sense due to the demand, but not if they start making alternate features for every single class out there. Of course, in the end, it depends on the execution. If Wizards can do it right, it might just work without deterring new DMs. Right now, we can only wait and see what they are going to come up with. But what do you think? Do you think that other classes should get alternate features too? Or are they fine as is? Comment below and let's start the discussion. Also, if you find this review useful, give it a thumbs up. If you are new here and want to see more Dungeons & Dragons content, please subscribe and press the bell button so that you'll be notified when new videos like this are published. CJ, over and out.